Let's continue with the second part of the unit number 3. It is calculus. Maybe again this will be a revision for you, but I'll use some different kind of example to get understanding of the calculus concept here. Many different methods are there that calculus internally contain, but as a part of syllabus we are having only differential calculus in it. But what's the meaning of it, where exactly in machine learning and statistics is applied, that also we will see step by step here. Okay, so let's start with an example. Simple example is there, which is shown over here. Of it, let's see. Samir and Ajay are traveling in a car, but the speedometer is broken. Okay, speedometer is not showing the speed. Fine. So Ajay asks Samir, so how fast we are going now? What's the speed that we are having? So Samir will tell us that, wait a minute. Well, in the last minute we went 1.2 kilometers. So we are going 1.2 kilometer per minute. That is x into 60 minute. That is into 60 minute per in an hour. So we'll get 1.2 kilometer into 60 minute. It will be 72 kilometer per hour, for example. So Samir tells that this is our speed. This can be our speed. Fine. So Ajay says, no, not an average for the last minute or even the last second. I want to know what is the speed right now. Okay, that is the question of Ajay. So Samir says, okay, let's measure it. And there's a road sign present onto it. Let's see this one. Okay. And with this concept ahead, he uses a method by which the speed of the car, current speed of the car is calculated. Okay, so we are at the sign for 0 seconds and at the distance is 0 meters. Exactly. For example, the car is moving, but at that particular sign, you were present for 0 second. So speed is 0 second. Okay, so just like speed is 0 meter per 0 seconds, 0 divided by 0, 0 divided by 0 is not, it's not defined number actually, that I don't know. So we can't calculate Ajay. I need to know some distance over some time. You're saying the time should be 0, so it can't be done. If time is not there, then how it is possible to check it? I want the current speed of the car. So how it can be calculated? It's like past speed we are told. Yeah, you are told about the same. That's a scientific method. It's okay. It's okay. But what's the current speed there? If you just consider time is 0, then how it is possible to identify the speed, and number of seconds are also 0. So there is no any method. There's no any standard technique to perform these operations. Now let's continue with this example to find how they, how which technique they uses to find a speed. That's pretty amazing. You'd like to think it's easy to work out the speed of the car at any point of time, but it's not. Even the speedometer of the car just shows us an average of how fast we are going for the last very short amount of time. Still, maybe the same speed is not currently present when you are currently traveling over here. Now see, let's about somewhat close, some different idea I'll show you, and then by which you can identify the technique which is used to find the perfect answers to multiple different kind of questions. The story is not over yet. Samir and Ajay get out of the car because they have arrived this location and Samir is about to do a stunt. You can see this mentioned there. Samir will do a jump of 20 meters building. See, it's shown over there how, from where he's jumping. And Ajay, as a photographer, asks, how fast will you be falling after 1 second? So you can see this one. This is I mentioned over here. Samir, he is present over here and he will be falling from the respective building, okay, on the floor here. So here time is 0 second. Time is 0 second. They are just doing an experiment how exactly the calculations are possible. Time is 0 second here. Will be jumping off, for example, at after 1 second he'll be here, or 2 second or 3 second, whatever, will be reaching at the bottom. Finally, fine. So the Samir uses the simplified formula to find the distance fallen. What is that? D is equal to 5t square. Now see, D is equal to 5t square. D is the distance fallen in meters. Okay, so how much, what's the speed that we have? Distance fallen in meter. T is the time for jump in seconds. Time from jumps. As soon as you started jumping, So how much time is elapsed in that? That is what the T is present. The formula is simpler version of how fast things fall under the gravity. Remember, this is the already defined formula that I am using over here. Fine. D is equal to half of GT square. Remember, half of GT square. We know the value of G. Yes. What's the value of G? 9.8 divided by 2. That is 4.9. That's why I have round figured it. Remember that. That is 4.9 is 5 directly. Fine. That is what I just mentioned. Because we don't require precision calculation. I require some identifiable calculation. That's why I have used this. So this is your formula. By using that formula, it is identified. T square times square. And you know that 9.8 meter per second square. That is the gravitational constant. Okay. And with the help of it, that's this formula I'm using to find a distance. So 1 by 2 G T square. So G is what we got is the gravitational constant. As I told, 9.8 divided by 2, 4.9. It will become 5 here. For example, at 1 second, Samir has fallen. Okay, after 1 second, it will be 5 meters. So D is equal to 5 T square. Correct. 5 T square. So we'll have 5 meters here. Okay, because value of 1, sorry, it's a 1 square here. It's given 12. It's 1 square actually. 5 T square. So 1 square after 1 second, Samir have fallen 1 meter. Sorry, 5 meters. Okay, like that. This is how we have identified it. Fine, using the distance and the formula here. So how fast is this? We know the speed and distance over the time. Speed is equal to distance divided by time. Correct? Distance divided by time means this number of meter per second, this number of kilometers per hour, like that we write. So at 1 second, speed is equal to 5 meter divided by 1 second. That is 5 meter per second. That's the speed. Correct. But says Ajay, again, the average speed, since you started the jump, I wanted to know the speed exactly 1 second. So we can set up the camera properly. Exactly 1 second. So he just can capture it like that. Fine. At 1 second, 5 meter is there. But after that, speed will change. Remember. Fine. So let's go get more closer. Again, that is an average speed. Since you started to jump, I wanted to know the speed exactly 1 second, so I can set up the camera properly. So here we can identify from 0 to 1, again 1 to onwards, it will go again. So when exactly 1 second, the speed is T 5 meter. Okay, 5 minus 5 and 1 minus 1 second, again 0 by 0 will be there. 0 by 0, every time we'll get 0 by 0, and again the result is indefinite. Not infinite, indefinite, no, not known results are there. This can be the problem. So mathematically, if you try to solve this particular concept, it will always give a indefinite, some unpredictable results. Unpredictable means not defined results, something like that will be identified for this case also. Fine. So again, Samir has a problem. Think about it. How can we find the speed at the exact instance of time? The question is this. Exact instance of time, what's the speed present there? Because we identify the current time is 0. If time is 0, the speed will also be 0 because of that formula which we have seen over here. Okay, speed will also be not 0 exactly, it is not predictable speed when time is equal to 0. In that case, this is what the formula is present. What's the distance and what's the time difference also? That's also the question to identify. They are both 0. Then we are giving nothing to calculate. That is 0 divided by 0. Distance and time both are 0. Then how can you calculate the speed at that particular point of time? Okay, this is what different kind of questions are coming in the mind of Samir. Okay, so he is having an idea. Invent a time so short it won't matter. Invent a time so short it won't matter. So it won't give any value to it. So we'll just call it as a delta t. Maybe in mathematics, you have learned about delta for multiple number of times. Delta is a difference. Fine. Delta is a difference basically from this to this. That's what delta we call delta T. Okay. Triangle is shown by that particular method. So Samir works out of a difference in distance between the T and T plus delta T. The time changes. That is what the difference that we have delta T and T. Original time is present there. So we have to find a difference in distance between the t and the delta t, t plus delta t, sorry. Now see, this is what the calculations we can do. Now, for example, at 1 second, the Samir has fallen 5t square is equal to 5 into 1 square, that is 5 meter. That's what already we have seen. Fine. And at 1 plus delta t seconds, delta t second, time difference seconds, Samir has fallen 5t square is equal to 5 into 1 plus delta t square meters. Fine. And if we expand that, 1 plus delta t square, bracket square, so how we'll get that one? You can see this one. This is what we're expanding it. 1 plus delta t square is equal to 1 plus delta t into 1 plus delta t. Like that we'll get. And we know this formula also. 1 plus 2 delta t plus delta t square. Okay, this is, we can identify it. Okay, 1 plus 2 delta t plus delta t square. So, at 1 plus delta t second, the Samir has fallen, like d is equal to 5 into, okay, this formula I just put over here. This formula we have put over here because this is present. Okay, this is replaced by this number here, 1 plus 2 delta t plus delta t square meters. Okay, and if you just again expand it, the formula is like this. D is equal to 5 plus 10 delta t, okay, plus is 5 into 1, here we got, plus 5 delta t square meters. That's what we got. And in summary, you can identify this now. Now check it out. In summary, at 1 second, distance equal to 1 meter, 5 meter, sorry. And at 1 plus delta t seconds, it is 5 plus 10 delta t plus 5 delta t square meters. I'm expanding it. Just expand. Previous equation that we have seen here, that we are expanding. Okay, and you can just check it here. So here we can identify t is equal to 1. Here 1 second is completed. And for example, if this is 1 plus delta t, the difference between that first time and the second time is called a delta t. So next time that we got t is equal to 1 plus delta t, this one. Fine. So that second we got. So the formula is created here, 5 plus 10 delta t plus 5 delta t square meter. That will be the difference between these two. So between 1 second and 1 plus delta t second, we get change in d is equal to 1 5 plus 10 delta t plus 5 delta t square minus 5 meter. Is it minus 5 meter? Already we have covered 5 meter there, that we are subtracting from the same. Okay, and from that t equal to 1 to t equal to 1 plus delta t, that time we are identifying here. So it started from some location to this particular point. Check it out. How would you identify? Change in d is equal to 5 plus delta n delta t plus 5 delta t square minus 5 meter. That will be the distance between this one. Change delta t is this and distance is this one, which is shown in the green color over here. Very small distance is present. Now see, change in the distance over the time. Now you can see this one, change in the distance over the time. Now we can see speed is equal to your distance divided by time. So I got the speed. This is, we are having a distance, sorry, this one, distance is this exactly, 5 plus 10 delta t plus this formula, correct? And what is your time? Time is delta t seconds. Time difference is delta t, that is the difference between the time, that is delta t present here. You can see this one, this is, I put in the formula, speed is equal to distance divided by time. So accordingly, I'm just going to solve this one, 10 delta t, because 5 minus 5, this one, okay, that will be deleted. Okay, so delta t as it is plus 5 delta t square meter divided by delta t here. And now we can identify that the speed is 10 plus 5 delta t meter per second. Correct. 10 plus 5 delta t meter per second. How? Because in both of them, delta t is common. Delta t is common. So what we'll have? Delta t will be out of the parenthesis. Delta t into 10 plus 5 delta t. Delta t is double over here. So one will be out from here, one will be out from here. And denominator and numerator will be taken off. They are same. That's why they will become one. And you can see 10 plus 5 delta t meter per second. That is your formula. That is your formula that we get identifying after solution of all. So the speed is 10 plus 5 delta t meter per second. And Samir thinks about the value delta t. So he wants delta t to be small, so it won't matter. So he might imagine that sinking towards the zero, he will get the speed is 10 meter per second. Remember how if you check the difference, time difference is zero, nothing. Then that second term will become zero. 5 into delta t, 5 into zero will become zero. So what remains? 10. So speed is equal to 110 meter per second. So this method is used to calculate the speed. Remember, at any unit of time, this method is applied. This is from that we can start. The same method can be applied to the same that we have seen the first example. The speed of the car at a specific unit of time. Okay, that is calculated with that. This particular method formula, this is what we call as the, what you call, so you can check it out. Samir has got the answer. Will be falling exactly at 10 meter per second. So it was not possible, but it is used, it is made possible with the help of a concept whose name I mentioned here is calculus. Calculus. So this is called as the calculus, the concept is mentioned. But remember, I have shown the thing mathematically only. Mathematically only, just go on with mathematics. But let's shrink it and find a method by which you can find the answers to such kind of the questions. Okay, this is considered a calculus theory. What exactly the calculus is? So calculus is a branch of mathematics that involves the study of rate of change. Study of rate of change. Rate of change, that's what to note. Yeah, so before calculus invented, all math was static. It could only help to calculate objects that were perfectly still, means fixed, constant, static. And on that only calculations were done. But calculus has given the changing idea, changing methods to the mathematics there. But the universe is constantly moving and changing. Remember, that's why calculus is important. No object from the stars in the space to subatomic particles or cells in the body are always at rest. Indeed, just about everything in the universe is constantly moving, constantly changing. And to perform the calculations on that, we require a technique to work that is called as a calculus. Fine. So this is how we have talked about how it's changing and the changing things. If you want to work and if you want to find the specific calculation, so we'll be making use of this. So calculus helps to determine how particles, stars and matter actually move and change in real time, how they actually move and actually change in real time. So this is how the changing techniques are, then changing methods can be solved, changing things can be solved with the help of the concept of calculus here. So calculus is a study of rate of change. Gottfried Leibniz and Isaac Newton, in 17th century, the mathematicians who invented the calculus independently. Remember, independently. It's a different method that you apply. So Newton invented first, but the Leibniz created a notation that mathematicians use today. The notations to use in the calculus created by the Leibniz, but the idea of calculus was devised from Sir Isaac Newton. So there are two types of calculus present. The first is differential calculus and second is integral calculus. As a part of our syllabus, we have only the differential calculus. Integral is also there. So we can identify the names which are mentioned. So they have given the birth to a new idea of mathematics. See, the word calculus comes from the Latin meaning small stone. So two techniques which I told, differential calculus and integral calculus. So differential calculus cuts something into small pieces and find how it changes. That is called a differential calculus. Okay. Into small pieces and then change rate of change is identified. Fine. Second is integral calculus. So integral calculus integrates, joins It differentiates, differentials. Integral, integrates. The small pieces together to find how much there is. That is part of integral calculus. So differential calculus and integral calculus are inverse of each other. Just like that, how multiplication and division are inverse. If you multiply, you can regain back by using division. Correct. Or subtract, add. So you perform subtraction, then you can perform additions. We'll get regain the previous value again. This is how the differential and integral calculuses are. So small pieces and how they are changing, and then again integrate them together to find the original data. It's called as integral calculus. Fine. So this is what the main difference that both of these calculations are containing. Now let's start with the concept and idea of the differential calculus. So what do you mean by the differential calculus that we will see? One, the concept is called as derivative. Okay, so we'll talk about the derivative concept, and then we'll go to use different kind of method, like what do you mean by the multivariate chain rule? What do you mean by the partial derivatives? What do you mean by different kind of matrix, Hessian matrix or Jacobian matrices are there? There are only these topics that we're going to learn in the differential calculus here. Now let's say that we increase x by a small amount, which we denote dx. We decrease or we increase by small amount, and assume that this change in dx increases y by the quantity dy. Okay, because of change in x, y is changing. Okay, like that, and that is dy. We can visualize this right angle triangle in which the x form the base and y is the height. You can see this one here. Right angle triangle. This is what we are, x axis is there. Okay. And here is the y axis. So as you change the value of x here, so proportional to that, dy is also changing here. This is dy. This is dx. Correct. Dy, this is dx. So you can just move. As you start moving ahead, the value of y will also change proportionally. If you just decrease the size of y, then also it will change, but the rate of decrease will be different. That case, if the whole value of y is less, rate of decrease will also be less. Like here, we have the 30 degree angle present here. Okay, like that. So dx is the rate of increasing or decreasing of x, and dy is the rate of increasing or decreasing y. If we add dx to x, see, if you add dx to x, it will cause an increase in y by dy. Exactly, correct. It will cause an increase in y by dy. So this corresponding change in dy can be described as dy by dx. Dy by dx. This is what shown over here. If you just add them, same thing will happen to the y also. Dy by dx. So the expression dy describes a rise in y, whereas dx describes the run or change in x by dx, which is why the ratio is called as rise over the run. This is the standard ratio which is used in differential calculus, called as rise over the run. In geometric term, rise over run is a slope of our hypotenuse. Slope of our hypotenuse, which we have seen here. See this one. The slope of the hypotenuse is rise over the run, dy by dx. Fine. Rise over the run. This is how terminology is now, it's created, dy by dx. So change of x respect to y, which is shown by this particular formula here. Okay, fine. So well, in this case, our hypotenuse is just right straight line. We have seen that the ratio between dx and dy is same at every point, is also equivalent to the ratio of x, y to x, sorry. Exactly same, because what's the proportionality of change is there for x, same proportionality will be there for the y also, because they're exactly straight, they're at 90%. Okay, but what do we do if instead of hypotenuse in the previous image, we need to find the slope of non-linear graph like this one, slope of the non-linear graph. So it's obviously the data is linear. You can see that perfect linear is there, hypotenuse that we can see, and the rate of change is also exactly constant. The proportionality is mentioned over here. And now we can see this graph present over here. And it is non-linear. Okay, it's like, you can check it, negative and positive both are there. And there's a curve present, which is moving from zero in negative direction also. From positive some value toward the negative some value, but not exactly linear, it is non-linear. The curve fashion is present over there. The curve is there. Now the slope and therefore our rise over the run changes constantly as we move along the line. See, in other words, the slope itself become a non-linear, just like over here. This is the original data. If you change this one, remember, if you change this one like that, so the case which I have shown over here, it's a linear. Either you can go above or below. Here also you can go above and below. In that case, the value will be constantly decrease or constantly increase, hypotenuse values. Fine. You can think logically and you can identify that. But if the case is like that, if it is non-linear in this way, then you can see the things which are shown in the blue color. This is the slope of the particular data that we can vary. So when you start from this side, the slope will be changing in this way here. And if it is come below, according okay, fine. See, it's a slope presented here in a blue line. Like it will change. So, note that if you, there's a connectivity that they are having. If you plot the data in the sine fashion, means the change of sine values, so we'll get something like this. Following origin, the green graph slowly picks up the steepness. Okay, until it becomes halt at the traffic light. Okay, deaccelerate. Fine. And after traffic light has turned green, it slowly starts accelerating again. Correct. This is what the graph is shown over here. You can see it's coming down here at zero. And again, after that, it's starting somewhat faster. Fine. Okay. Getting this. So after the traffic light has turned green, it slowly start accelerating again. Fine. So the green graph capture the actual change in the speed, while the blue graph record the rate of change in speed at every point in time. Observe that. See it again. Here, rate of change is there. This is how it's constantly, because both are at 0 point. It will start decreasing rate of change. Here, no rate of change is there. And after that, again, it is starting increasing. So rate of change will also start increasing like this. This case. But both are at the rest at zero position over here. Fine. Getting it. So actual change in the speed and the rate of change in the speed, that will be shown by this particular concept. So what is derivative now? See, here also we have talked about differential calculus is basically focusing on rate of change. So this is what rate of change is there. It should be obvious by now that we cannot capture the slope of the green graph in simple slope of y over x. Correct. But to determine the slope of the green graph, we could have to create an infinite number of infinitely small right angle triangle at every point along the line. Correct. Every point, very small, small right angle. This is what I have shown in the first case presented there. We have to create that right triangle and then we can check the speed difference. And then accordingly, the dy by dx will be calculated. Fine. But when the gradual increase or decrease is there in logarithmic fashion, like in curve fashion, then what to do? In that case, so now this is infinitely small ratio you obtain at every one of these triangles is known as the differential, and it is expressed as dy by dx that we have seen in the previous topic also. dy by dx, rate of change of y divided by rate of change of x, which we call as a derivative here. Okay, so here d stands for delta, that is rate of change. We have seen that rate of change in the first example that we have seen, delta triangle, delta triangle, that's why the name given as d, and so known as the differential. And the blue graph that captures the rate of change at every point on the green graph is known as the derivative of the green graph. It's a derivative of green graph. Make sure, see this one again. This is original data and it's a derivative of it. The blue one is a derivative and the green one is the change. Your speed is changing and according to the derivative of it is there. This is the derivative of the green line. Okay, so the blue graph that captures the rate of change and every point of green graph, that's what the derivative of the green graph. Of course, x and y have to be somehow related to be able to obtain the ratio. So we can therefore express the derivative as a function itself. So derivative itself is a function, right? Rate of change of y divided by the d of x. This function is called as a derivative function. And with the derivative function, this rate of change can be calculated. But the thing is that they are changing, and for that changing, the derivative will show you the rate of change. So remember, in the graph y is usually expressed as the function of x. Our green graph now can be expressed as y is equal to x cube. Y is equal to x cube. We have seen that, just like we have used the matplotlib when I plotted that. When non-linearity is there, see, in linear algebra, we have seen the linear functions are present. When they are linearly connected, they have slope and line. Now, but what will happen when your non-linearity is there? Their rate is different. In line, rate is same throughout. Rate of change is same throughout in linear regression, linear algebra. But when you talk about a differential calculus, in that case, rate of change is different. It is continuously changing differently. So here, the non-linear equation is there. Y is equal to x cube. Now, here, if you check x is here and at x cube, so it will be changing like that here in this direction. So the equation will contains a non-linear equation present here, which contains the exponent of a variable equal to some degree, some number. Fine. So that time we are going to make use of the derivative function. So function is like f of x is equal to x cube. So f of x is the function. F of x is basically a different expression for y in this particular case. Correct. Obviously, we represent what function is present in that, means function is expressed in terms of the output variable. In terms of output variable, so output variable is y. What are you expecting output? Y. And what is your input? Exactly, you are doing on input x cube. That's why the function that we write over here is f of x equal to x cube. So we can create a right angle triangle along the graph f of x from any point, that is x to the f of x to another point, x plus dx, change in d, x plus dx, just like previous example we have seen, delta 1 plus delta t from 1 second onwards. So from x onwards, change in it, d of t, okay, comma f of x plus dx. Okay, so we can express that from, so this what we change is added here. So change is added, change is dx, so x plus dx, and f of x is converted to f of x plus dx, like that, it's converted. And now see, we will get this function like this one. See, for example, for every, is very big triangle shown, actually triangle is very small, and now we can observe that with f of x here, this is the f of x, correct. So here is your y value, we identify this, here is the y value present on the y axis here. So f of x is equal to x cube. So if I made x cube here, that value will be y presented here. But how it is calculated? So you can check, this is your change of x, x plus dx, okay, x plus dx, and this is f of x plus dx. Fine, this way we calculated it. So this actually triangle is shown very big, but very small triangle will be there. So when you make it more and more small, it rate of change will be having more precision value there. And accordingly, this function we have calculated here. So yes, now rise over the run formula. So exactly, dy is called as rise and dx is called as run. And this is, that's why it's called as rise over the run formula. So accordingly, you would arrive at the slope of this triangle by the following calculation. See that rise divided by run is equal to dy by dx is equal to, now what we got dy? Dy is equal to f of x plus dx minus f of x divided by x plus dx minus x. Okay, so original functions and their change of rate functions. Fine, so if you simplify that, we will get here. So see this x and x, this will be deleted, they're subtracted. X minus x, zero. What do you got? Dx. Only run we got. Since the slope is changing continuously in a non-linear graph, we need to make a triangle as small as possible. This is what I told. We have to make this triangle as small as possible. In fact, indefinitely small to arrive at the correct slope at the point of time, at that particular point. Correct slope, we have to calculate there. So as we cannot really calculate the slope of an infinite small triangle, we can only approximate it by getting x as close to zero as possible by this particular method. As close to zero, maybe 0.0000 something value is there, but will be close to zero. And accordingly, the more precise precision can be achieved with the help of rise over the run. What's the rise and what's the run? So that ratio we can identify with the help of dy by dx. This is our derivative formula presented here. Remember, that's what the meaning of derivative is. Common idea of derivatives is identified. Then see, so in machine learning also, we whenever to check the concept of rise over the run, how it's changing according to time, what's the rate of change is present. So there we can apply the formula of dy by dx. So many function, many formulas are there. That's the secondary part. We just identify what's the meaning of derivative is, how exactly the derivative satisfies, find a solution to this particular problems. Okay, this is a common idea which is used. Basically, if you compare with linear algebra, this concept is also used equally in many of the algorithms. When you have to change, we have to observe the change of the data, so we'll be making use of this technique for most of the time in many machine learning algorithm here. Connected to that, we have a concept called as partial derivative. Partial derivative is not 100%, the partial derivatives. So how exactly, what exactly meaning of partial derivative? Just give with an example also, and what method is used to denote that also we'll see. So many real life problems in areas such as physics, mechanical engineering, data science, many important parts can be described the function of more than one independent variable. Obviously, they are there. It's obvious that we are going to have this more than one input variable, independent variable. So how can you know how the change in one particular variable affect the system described by your function? Yes, how the change in one particular variable affects the system described in your function. Okay, this is what we call as the partial derivative. Partial derivative, I just take an example, the diagram which is shown over here. Okay, it's a cylinder. We know the formula to find the volume of cylinder. For instance, the volume of cylinder, that can be described as a function of its height s and its radius r. Correct. So r is the radius of that cylinder and height h is the height of it. So volume of cylinder can be calculated by the formula v is equal to pi r square h. Pi r square is already the it's the area of circle, that's what is present here, into h, height we multiplied, and based on that the volume of this cylinder is calculated. Everyone knows, we know the geometry, we have learned about this formula already. Now suppose you want to describe how the volume changes in response to varying just the height, keeping the radius constant. Exactly, how volume changes response to varying just height means, I mean, how height is changing and what's the proportionality of volume changing there. But our pi r square radius, sorry, radius is common, it's constant. To achieve this, we differentiate the function describing the volume just respect to h, treating everything else including r as a constant, we give this function over here. Now check it, h I did not mention over yet. So we'll have the expression v dash is equal to pi r square. We know that what is pi r square. Pi r square is the just area of that particular circle, plane circle, no height. Third parameter is not there, third dimension is not there. We are not using that in third dimension view. Pi r square, fine. So, but wait, it's a formula of area of circle. We know that. Yes. So this make a perfect sense. If we increase h by an infinitely small amount, okay, it's likely stacking circle on the top of the cylinder. We start increasing it, increase. So that circle will be on the top, stacking on the top of that particular cylinder. Correct. This is where the circle is, which is at the top of it. Start increasing the height. Infinitely, fine. Now the area of circle is equivalent to the partial derivative of v with respect to h, correct? Partial derivative of v with respect to h. So the formula will be like this. Here I am using the delta symbol. Debba is used also somewhere, but we call it a delta. Delta v divided by delta h is equal to pi r square. So delta is a partial derivative symbol. We use it instead of d when you are differentiating multivariate function with respect to one variable. Multivariate function with respect to one variable. So what we require, we have to observe how v changes, how v volume changes if we only increase or decrease the r. We would take a partial derivative of v with respect to r. So as we know, v is equal to pi r square h. So delta v by delta r is equal to 2 pi r h. Now one to mention there, what exactly we calculated it? 2 pi r into h. 2 pi r, what is the 2 pi r? We know 2 pi r is perimeter of the circle. 2 pi r h. Using that, we can see the partial derivative of v with respect to r, with respect to radius basically. And using this, this is possible to calculate. Remember, fine. So the derivative is nothing but a slope of function at a particular point. Slope of a function at particular point. If you take the multivariate function like f of x, y is equal to x square plus 3y. So obviously the is told it's a non-linear function. So x square that I mentioned over here. The derivative with respect to one variable x, which will give a slope along the x dimension. So delta of f of xy divided by delta of x is equal to 2x for this particular case. And you just can check it out. Actually, this is somewhat critical to understand. When we plot the data in three dimensional data, that time only it is possible to check it over here. So I'm using two variable over here, x and y. Now you can see x on this axis, y on this axis. If you just check the two dimensions, so what we will get, only this line we will get, how they are changing, that will identify that. But in third dimension, when you have this z axis also, that this one presented here, you can identify the complete plane, how the variations are present inside this data. This is called as a partial derivative. And partial derivative, okay, there is an example we are having, that gradient descent algorithm. There similar idea of partial derivative is used, and the partial derivative we are going to identify the ideal values of the results. Okay, partial derivative, that we can apply it there. Fine. So just remember that. Okay, so before proceeding further, let's take a break of 3 minutes, and after that we will continue. Thank you.